Hello viewers, welcome to the Classic Education YouTube channel. I am Dr. R.V. Chettiguppi, the History Faculty from Classic KAS and IAS Study Circle, Dharwad. Today, I am with another important historical topic, which is very useful for the mains examination, whether it is a UPSC or KPSC. So very soon, the KPSC students will be going for the main examination. So in main examination, here one of the topic which the students have to concentrate is the growth of linguistic states in India. So I have entitled this here the topic here as the story of linguistic states in India, are also known as the unification movement. So usually here it is understood that here the November 1st, which is taken as the state formation day, many states were established in India, including the Kannada state, which we today call it as Karnataka. Along with Karnataka, we find many other states also came into existence. So at the very outset, on behalf of the Classic KAS and IAS Study Circle and on my personal behalf, I extend warm greetings to all the people of those states who celebrate their state formation day on November 1st. So we will take up the story, the path how these linguistic states came into existence. It forms a very interesting aspect in the history of India. The last part of the 19th century witnessed two important movements. We usually call it as the parallel movements. So one was, as you know, that the struggle of the Indians for the independence. And the second one was the demand for the formation of the linguistic states, or the unification movement. So what is this unification movement? It is the demand of the people to merge the territories where the common language is spoken. The merging of the territories of the common language and forming a state there. So which we refer it as the linguistic states. So this we notice in the last part of the 19th century. And the pioneer of this, who proposed for this linguistic state organization, was here Bal Gangadhar Tilak. Bal Gangadhar Tilak was the person who proposed for this linguistic states, who was highly influenced by the two movements which were took place in Europe, the unification of Italy and unification of Germany. Tilak was very much influenced by this, particularly the architect of the Italian unification, Joseph Mazzinin, was an inspiration, motivation to Bal Gangadhar Tilak. So we find Bal Gangadhar Tilak in 1891, in his paper, Kesari, he wrote an article here demanding the formation of the linguistic promise. So this was the beginning of the claim for the linguistic states. The linguistic province was proposed by Bal Gangadhar Tilak, who was one of the prominent leader of the extremist phase, also known as Lokamanya Maharashtra Kesari. Later, it was in 1895, the demand for linguistic province came from the people of Orissa. Orissa, Bihar and Bengal formed one here, the province called as the Bengal province. The people of Orissa wanted to have an independent linguistic province. 1895, we come across, that was here mainly proposed. The linguistic here province demand started in Orissa. Followed by this, 1903, Benegal Ramrao, and 1906, S.S. Settlur, when they were delivering a lecture at Dharwad, the district headquarters, one of the important cultural here also a site in Karnataka. So when they were delivering a lecture, both of them insisted on the formation of the linguistic province of Kannada, Benegal Ram Rao and S.S. Settlur. They demanded for the linguistic province of Kannada there. So this is how we start in different states of India. The demand for the linguistic provinces here came. However, Karnataka or Kannada state forms as a model to other states in India for the unification movement. So later it was in 1907 and 1908, one of the person from Karnataka, Dharwad, who took the initiation or to kindle the fire of the unification was Alur Venkata Rao, who has been called as the architect of the Karnataka unification, also called as the Karnataka Kulapurohita. 1907, Alur Venkata Rao here organized the Kannada Writers Conference at Dharwad. 1907 and 1908. Two Kannada Writers Conferences were organized at Dharwad. Dharwad is considered as the cradle of the Karnataka unification. And here the proposal was made to the writers, Kannada writers, here through their writings to spread the awareness about the Karnataka unification. So this work was mainly undertaken by Alur Venkata Rao. Organizations like Karnataka Vidyavartaka Sangha, which was established in Dharwad in 1890 by R.H. Deshpande. So this organization worked for the unification movement of Kannada in the Mumbai Karnataka region. So also in the Mysore princely state, we have Kannada Sahitya Parishat, which was established in Bengaluru in 1915, when Sir M. Vishweshwaraya was the Diwan and Nalvadi Krishna Raj Vadiyar was the king. So this took the initiation for the unification movement here in the Mysore princely state. Karnataka Sabha at Dharwad 1916, here also joined hands for the unification movement in the Mumbai Karnataka region. So the message of the unification was spread to the nook and corner of the Kannada territories through these organizations. These were the source of inspiration to the people for the unification. Alur Venkata Rao's book, Karnataka Gata Vaibhava, is considered as the Bible of Kannada unification or Karnataka unification. Karnataka Gata Vaibhava. So, why I am insisting on this here, the Karnataka unification, is because it was on this model in other states of India the unification movement has been organized. Hence, Karnataka is the model for the unification movement in India. Hence, I am giving more importance to this, and the students can take these points for their here mains preparation, the KPSC students. Later, 1916, Bal Gangadhar Tilak and Mrs. Annie Besant started the Home Rule movement, which also emphasized on the linguistic provinces. In Home Rule, one of the here the demand made was the linguistic provinces. 1917, Indian National Congress in its Calcutta session, which is also a very historic session, because it had the first woman president, that is Mrs. Annie Besant. Proposal was made for the establishment of the Congress provincial committees on the basis of language. On the basis of the language, here we have the proposal came. And it was here accepted, and we find later on the Congress committees came to be established based on the language. For example, 1920 Nagpur session, which was presided by Vijay Veera Raghavacharya. He was the president, and the permission was granted for the establishment of a KPCC, Karnataka Provincial Congress Committee. So in this Nagpur session, nearly 800 Kannadigas had participated. And under the leadership of Raghavendra Kadpa, the demand was made for the Air Canada Congress Provincial Committee. And it was accepted and it was given. And 1920, at Gadag, KPCC headquarters was established with Gangadhar Rao Deshpande as the first president. So this is how we find the progress of the unification movement was there. 1924, Karnataka Ekikarana Sabha established at Belgaum or Beligave. The poem of Hulagol Narayan Rao, Udayavagali Namma Chalava Kannada Nadu, inspired the unification movement. It is considered as the song of the unification. Udayavagali Namma Chalava Kannada Nadu, the poem written by Hulagol Narayan Rao. So this how mainly, and the Karnataka Ekikarana Sabha adopted the same methodology that was done by Indian National Congress, organizing the sessions in different parts of the territories. To kindle the fire of the unification, Karnataka Ekikarana Sabha organized its annual sessions every 2 years in mainly the different Air Canada territories. In different Kannada territories, we find they used to arrange these here the conferences to inspire the people for unification. So this is how the unification movement here awareness was created. But remember, along with that, the national movement was also going on. The national movement is also important. First priority was for our independence. Unification was the secondary, but the concept was kept alive by these leaders through these organizations. 1926, Hindustan Sevadal, which had been established in 1924 at Hubli by N.S. Hardikar, it conducted a signature movement, that is, we are collecting the signature of the people who preferred the unification of Karnataka. 36,000 signatures were collected. That was one of the things which here we notice the people were now here wanting to have that linguistic state. And it was in 1928 the most historic event in the history of the linguistic movement in India was Motilal Nehru Report, popularly known as Nehru Report, 1928, which is also called as the blueprint of the present constitution. It was in this, the report, the recommendation came for linguistic states, 1928. However, 1929, Simon Report rejected the claim of the linguistic states. Simon Report did not mention anything about the linguistic states. So, however, we notice the people did not lose their courage. They continued with their effort to have the linguistic province or the linguistic states. And we come across 1936, the formation of Orissa, the first linguistic province in pre-independent India. Remember, here, the aspirants, that usually, which is the first linguistic state of India, when we ask you, the answer you will be giving is Andhra Pradesh. But however, remember, in pre-independent India, Orissa is an example for it. And the efforts here put for the establishment of the Orissa linguistic state, here as the linguistic province, was Madhusudan Das, who is mainly responsible for that Orissa linguistic province, 1936. But the difference is that it was pre-independent. Before independence, it was established. And 1947, after the independence, here we find the appointment of Linguistic Provinces Commission was set up. Linguistic Provinces Commission was set up with three members, S.K. Dhar, J.N. Lal, and Panna Lal, popularly called as a Dhar Commission. This is the famous commission what we have got, the Dhar Commission, appointed after independence in order to discuss over the formation of the linguistic states. And the Dhar Commission, so what was the report given? It did not favor the linguistic provinces. Dhar Commission did not favor the linguistic provinces, but proposed for geographical features, financial self-reliance, and administrative viability as the criteria for the formation of the linguistic states. So this was what a Dhar Commission report came. Geographical features are to be considered. Financial self-reliance and administrative viability are to be here the criteria for the formation of the linguistic states. So immediately what we have from the different parts of India, delegation came and requested the Prime Minister Jawaharlal Nehru to reconsider the issue of the linguistic states. So it was when at Jaipur the delegation met. The Kannada delegation was led by S. Nijalingappa. The Kannada delegation to Jaipur to meet Jawaharlal Nehru was led by here mainly S. Nijalingappa. And the result was, we see, 1948 a new committee was established called as JVP committee. JVP committee. So it had three members: Jawaharlal Nehru, Vallabhbhai Patel, and Pattabhi Sitaramaiah. The three members here, the committee was established here in order to discuss about the linguistic state, to reissue, to reconsider this issue. So here, the commission report, what it said, in 1949, the commission report was given. It said, time is not suitable for the formation of new provinces. Still, the time is not suitable. However, it accepted the presence of strong sentiment towards the linguistic states, particularly Telugu state. It showed an inclination towards the Telugu state, the JVP committee. JVP committee showed an inclination towards the here Telugu state. But the first statement you can see, it is not yet suitable. However, here mainly the state was considering the sentiments of the people and it was showing inclination towards the here establishment of linguistic state. So that was what the linguistic state we say. And we find after India became republic, general elections were held. Now we find in a Telugu region, the demand for the linguistic state started, and it was Potti Sriramalu who began the movement for the formation of the Telugu state. 1953, Potti Sriramalu undertook the fast satyagraha for the formation of the Telugu state. After a span of 57 days fast, here, because of his ill health, he met his death. Potti Sriramalu, during his first satyagraha, here he had to face the ill health, financial, mainly the health problems, and that resulted in his death. And immediately the condition was very severe, tense, and the center decided to establish the first linguistic state of independent India. October 1st, 1953. The Telugu state was established, or Andhra Rashtram was established. It was in 1953, the first linguistic state we notice. And to reconsider the issue of other states, to look into the matter of the other states on linguistic, because at that time, not only Telugu, Malayalam were also demanding, Kannada people were demanding, Punjabis were demanding, Assamese were demanding. So there was the mainly the demand from here the different parts of India. To consider this issue, here 1953 States Reorganization Commission was appointed with again three members, Fazal Ali, H.N. Kunzru, and K.M. Fanikar. The three members, however, popularly known as Fazal Ali Commission. The Fazal Ali Commission, here we find, was appointed to reorganize the states on the linguistic basis. 1955 report submitted led to the drafting of States Reorganization Act. Fazal Ali report led to the formation of the States Reorganization Act, and it was brought into force on November 1st, 1956. So the report accepted the linguistic state formation, and based on that the act was formed, the States Reorganization Act, and November 1st, 1956, here it was brought into force, which established 14 linguistic states in India. The 14 linguistic states were established in India: Andhra Pradesh, Assam, Bihar, Bombay, Jammu Kashmir, Kerala, Madhya Pradesh, Mysore, Orissa, Punjab, Madras, Rajasthan, Uttar Pradesh, and West Bengal. The 14 states that were established, and these are the 6 union territories that we are not considering it, but the 6 here, the 14 states here, most of them were linguistic states. So the linguistic states here, the movement achieved its success with the passing of the States Reorganization Act 1956. November 1st, we have these linguistic states that were formed in India. So in 1956, you can notice the India map. India map, the 14 linguistic states have got. This was the map of India here, which shows the 14 linguistic states that were established on November 1st, 1956. So this was the story of the linguistic states in India, how the linguistic states were formed. So students, here you can take the mainly the discussion, the points for your mainly the mains examination, and prepare yourself here for the mains examination. So with this, I will end my lecture, and before I leave the dais, I just say, if you have not subscribed for the Classic Education YouTube channel, do subscribe it, and I'll meet you once again with another new topic. Thank you.